because we don't have those yet. The 2015 state and national data does not come out for another year or so. The methodology is pretty much the same. The questionnaire for the middle school is smaller than the high school questionnaire. It's actually 90 questions as opposed to 120. And it's administered during a single class period, again, by our amazing physical educators. The middle school survey categories are the same, except there's less questions in each category. But there is built-in redundancies and built-in data sampling so that we can clean the data and we can make sure we have the best sample possible. So let's start with some good news. At least one trusted adult to talk to in the school and in the community. The question for school, we've seen a huge increase from 53% in 2005 to 71% in 2015. That's outstanding to see that level of change. And then also for the parent side, having a parent or someone in the community that they can trust and talk to, that's also gone up quite a bit, and that's exciting to see as well. Grades, mostly A's and B's. I think that this slide gives you an example of how reliable the data is. So you can see that kids reported their grades as mostly A and B. It was 91% in 2011, also in 13 in 2015. So that's three sets of young people that are taking the survey in three different every 2 year cycles reporting the same exact information. And then there is a little bit more females in the sample than males. And then you can also see that for the sixth graders, less sixth graders reported higher grades compared to the eighth graders. So just something to keep in mind, whether that's perception, because this is their perceived reporting of them getting A's and B's, or if it's that as they get confident, their grades improve. So that might be something just for the schools to kind of look at. We asked some negative stress questions. This was actually a line of questioning that Assistant Superintendent Craig Martin helped us develop, because where he is so much about stress management, what's going on with coping, we felt like this was an important area. So this next group of questions gets into that. And we asked them directly, what causes the most negative stress? And then we gave them a list of categories. And what we found is that school demands and busy schedule were the two leading areas of stress. Not surprising, because that fills up most of their day. And then some of the ones that are smaller, which I think is important for adults to see, is that social pressure and extracurricular activities is actually quite low. And I think sometimes we perceive it to be the other way around. So just important to keep in mind that a lot of what is filling their day and what might be pressing is the things that we actually have control over, the structure, how it plays out, what's going on, how we can support young people. So there's a lot of room in here to make improvements. And I know Dr. Doherty has talked previously about the idea of start time and delayed looking at sleep and all that kind of stuff, and I think that plays into also the ability to get enough sleep and stress management. Then also parent and family demands, 10%, and then other family personal issues, another 10%. So if you add those two together, that's also a significant area to keep in mind. The other one, worries about future, 8%. I just want to point that out because I think we hear a lot about young people being placed under enormous pressure to really think about their future. I think it's important to see that it is only 8% at this point for the middle school, and that's good, that they're not thinking too far ahead and they're not feeling overwhelming pressure around that, because in some other districts that number is actually higher. What do you find most stressful about school? So this question was slightly different, and then we gave them a list of options. Studying things hard to understand, teacher expectations, and keeping up with work were the three categories that were the most significant. So that's important to keep in mind. I know we're always talking about expectation versus the ability of students to keep up. And there have been a lot of changes in how we are able to, a lot of changes in the amount of time we have to work with students, and sometimes that can create more pressure. Bullying. So I'm gonna show you Reading compared to the national data, compared to the state data. Keeping in mind that the national data is very different because, again, it's a small sample of states. So we're talking 16 states, and they come from all different parts of the country. So the sample is not weighted in the sense that the state sample is. So it is a little bit different. So those numbers are always going to look a little bit higher for you. So Reading 33%, which is great compared to the other two. And then the other measure is our 10-year average versus the US 10-year average, and it's a little bit lower. So that's good news. Cyberbullying, this is an area that, you know, we're talking a lot about in terms of the impact cyberbullying can have outside of the school day. And one thing I thought was interesting was the amount of young women who were troubled by cyberbullying compared to young men. So the rate is actually much higher for our young ladies compared to our young men. And then also there's an increase in seventh grade as well. Harassment, this is a question that they get asked in terms of if they've experienced harassment, what did they think it was because of? What was their perception? So 31% say that they experienced some form of harassment at school, and again, this is their perception, it's in the eye of the beholder. And these were the areas that they pointed out, physical characteristics, race, ethnic origin, someone thought that you were GLBTQ, unwanted sexual comments or attention, something to do with your group of friends, or other reasons. And you can see how significant the physical characteristic piece is, which makes sense because of how, you know, the time in middle school, but that's also really hard because you can't change that, you know, really, really hard. Violence-related behavior. These are the three major measures that we look at. So young people who say they've been in a physical fight, carried a weapon, or injury from a fight that required medical treatment. The good news is if you look at all of our measures, we're heading in the right direction. There's less movement on the carrying a weapon, although it's going down a little bit. But I think you can see been in a physical fight is quite significant. Looking at this data by gender, I think is important. And any of the gender comparisons are just to kind of give you a different look at it. It's not the end all be all, just one kind of slice of the information. You can see that young men were significantly more likely to report carrying a weapon compared to the females, more likely to have been in a physical fight quite a bit. And then injury from a fight, about the same. So I think that's interesting to think about. And then on the other side, being hurt physically or sexually by a date, our young ladies were more likely to have been hurt compared to our young men. Physical activity, screen time, and sleep. This area looks at how much physical activity they reported, how much time they've spent on a screen, and then also video games, and then how much sleep they're getting. The good news is sleep's looking good, except sixth grade to eighth grade falls off quite a bit. And if we look at this all the way up to the high school, it does the same thing. So that's one that we got to think about. How do we help them get the sleep that they need to keep going? Because that's not much to go on. Looking at weight issues, disordered eating, this one is also broken out by gender just to give you a different picture. Our young ladies were more likely to describe themselves as overweight. What's interesting is we ask a question on how they perceive their weight, if they perceive themselves to be overweight about the right weight. And then we also ask what their actual weight is, and that weight is calculated for what the average weight should be for their age and their height. And our young ladies always calculate their weight as being above average, that they're overweight. Their actual weight is always average. So their perception is it's higher. Our young men usually perceive it to be about what it is. So just something to keep in mind. Trying to lose weight, our young ladies were significantly more likely to be thinking about trying to lose weight. Fasting's much higher. Using diet pills or liquids is a little bit higher, but our young men are starting to increase in that area. And then using laxatives to lose weight is also higher. Non-suicidal self-injury, this is a line of questioning around injuring yourself on purpose without the intention of ending one's life. So it's the idea of causing harm to oneself to sacrifice a part of the body for to release pressure, to deal with pain as a coping mechanism. And it can include cutting, burning, scratching, picking. It also can include ingestion of drugs, although in our particular line of questioning, we don't get into that level of detail, so kids are gonna interpret the question the way they interpret it. You can see that it's been pretty steady. I'm not sure if you can see down here, it's a little hard to see, but if we look at our Reading rates compared to the state rate, they're about 13 to 14% in either year that we've been asking the question. So it's about what the state rate is right now. One of the depression-related indicators that we ask, you can see about 15% of young people reported that they were feeling depressed. And when we look at our 10-year average, it's pretty close. It's slightly lower than the state rate. I think one of the important things to think about is young people who've had a depressive episode are more likely to initiate alcohol, substance use, and also possibly be at risk for nicotine use as well. Depression and suicide related. So as I mentioned in the last presentation, we ask a series of questions to get at the level of suicidality. The first question is related to the depressive indicator. Have you felt sad or hopeless for 2 or more weeks and you felt like you couldn't continue your normal activities? Young women were more likely than young men to report feeling that depressive indicator. They also were more likely to have seriously considered suicide to make a plan. But when you look at actually attempted, our young men and our young ladies are exactly equal. One of the things that's important to keep in mind is the seriously considered is very closely tied to making a plan and actually attempting. So taking it very seriously when young people report any thoughts of suicide is something that everyone in the district is being taught about through mental health first aid. Suicide-related attitudes and behaviors. In 2005, it was 15%, 9%, and 5%. In 2015, it's 12%, 9%, and 4%. So we're seeing some movement, but not a ton, and that's over a 10-year time frame. If we look more closely, you can see that it is slightly lower than our 10-year average. It's lower than the national average and the state average in all of the areas. Again, we'd like these numbers to be zero, but in comparison, just trying to give you some context. One thing I just want to point out in terms of suicide in Massachusetts, there was a report that just came out last week that reported that the state has lower rate of suicides compared to the rest of the nation. Again, we have that lower rate of injury compared to other states, which is good news. The Samaritan organization handles a ton of crisis calls, and they actually responded to 187,000 calls for people asking for help around suicidality, which I think people often forget how active that organization is and what a resource it is in our state. 60% of all suicides were among individuals in Mass, ages 35 to 64. So we talk a lot about young people, and as well we should when we come to the school committee, but keeping in mind that our adults are also at risk. And I wanted to share the chart with you just so you could see in the 35 to 44 range and the 45 to 54, very significant rate of adult suicide. And then they were also able to tie back the circumstances associated with the suicide. And what they found was a lot of it was related to a current mental health problem or current treatment, meaning that they weren't able to find the right treatment that worked for them, a history of suicide attempts, a substance problem, and also a job or financial problem. There was also a mental wellness report of the nation's young people, which looked nationally at what was going on with mental health. And what they found is more stigma led to less access to services, lower recognition of the prevalence of illness, and failure to see multifaceted disparities across, whether it's by gender, by race, ethnicity. And the reason I point that out, because it's very important for all of you to see this data and to grapple with it, and this is just the start of a longer conversation that our district is gonna be having around these issues. And the stigma piece is huge. It really does prevent us from dealing with these issues. So the more we can do to break down the stigma, the more likely young people are to reach out for help. Young people did report if they received treatment for mental health. Actually, 12% reported in 2013, 14%, so we saw an increase in 2015. And then if you look at 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, you can see that our 6th graders were a little bit more likely to be receiving treatment compared to our 7th and our 8th graders. So just a reminder of as early intervention as we can, that's good news. We added a new mental health question regarding concentration or making decisions due to physical, mental, or emotional problems. 14% said that yes, they were having trouble with that, and then another 11% said they're not sure. And so that's an area to think about is young people may be feeling a little bit on edge about it, but not really sure if they need to seek help or not. And that's an area that we want to do a better job. It's really tied back into the work that's going on with the multi-tiered support system of having these tier one supports for everybody. And there's also perception differences. Young people may perceive that they are having trouble, but on the parent side, only 5% of parents, 5% of children ages 4 to 17 were reported by a parent to have serious difficulties with emotions. So that's a lower amount that perceive there to be a problem compared to young people who report at about triple that. Helmet and seatbelt safety. Sometimes we forget about the basics, so I want to make sure that we remind folks how important those two issues are. And I know our officer, Deputy Chief Sagala, would definitely throw his hat in the ring on this one. We've seen a little bit of an increase in always wearing a helmet, 29%. This is of young people who say that they're riding a bike or using skateboard or et cetera. Wearing a seatbelt, we've seen that rate significantly increase, and we know that that's a protective area for injury prevention, so that's really good news. We ask young people, have you gotten into a car with an impaired driver, either impaired by alcohol or by drugs? And we saw a significant decrease in that over the last few years. And then we started asking the bottom row is the drug impaired question. So did you get in a car with a driver that was drug impaired? And that's about 6% and 16% for alcohol. Now, we don't ask them who was driving the car. It could be anybody. It could be an older sibling, could be another adult, could be anybody. In terms of tobacco and nicotine, you had a presentation on the issue of vaping not too long ago, and we talk a lot about the importance of preventing young people from using nicotine because it is one of the most addictive substances that we have. And what we found is that when we look at our rates, e-vapor is the highest area of concern at 7%. We're glad to see that our cigarette rate is going down, but we're concerned about e-vape use going up. The good news is some regulations have been already put in place, and since some of the regulations went in place about more restrictions around buying, more restrictions around marketing, they've already seen a 12% drop nationally in e-vape use just in the last month. So something's starting to come together, so that's good news. Prevalence of lifetime alcohol use. I'm not sure if you remember, but when we talked to you about alcohol use at the high school level, we saw a significant drop in underage drinking, and we're seeing the same drop in middle school use, which we're really excited about. And then this is just another look at it. You can see the different areas of lifetime use, using alcohol in the last 30 days, and binge drinking. When we look at other substances, we look at marijuana, binge drinking, which is consuming 5 drinks in a few hours, and misuse of prescription drugs. You can see that in 2013, we started to see more of an issue with prescription drugs, and that's an area that we'll be continuing to watch. And looking at marijuana, we added a new question this time about synthetic marijuana because it's more popular than it was on previous surveys. And what we found is a decrease in regular marijuana use and a slight increase in synthetic marijuana use. Lifetime prevalence of substances. So this is, have they ever used this substance or misused the substance? And you can see that e-vapor products are the most significant, followed by inhalants, and then all the way down to misuse of prescription drug stimulants. One area that sometimes folks don't think about is over-the-counter medications, misuse of over-the-counter medications, and that's an area that we definitely want to make sure we're spreading the word about prevention and also making sure we're reaching our younger youth, particularly in the elementary level. Perception of parental disapproval. This was an area that I think Ms. Webb brought out at the last session about looking at a couple different areas. How do young people perceive their parents would feel about them using a substance? Then we also have a set of questions on how would they perceive their peers would feel, and how do they perceive their own risk of harm. So this first one is perception of parental disapproval. And one area that you can see that's a little bit different is the drinking alcohol nearly every day. That one, the perception is a little bit different compared to the others in 2015. Perception of peer disapproval. Pretty close, but a little bit of a difference with they actually perceive their peers would disapprove more than their parents would. Not by much, but. Lifetime prevalence of sexual intercourse by gender and grade. This is always a tough area of questioning to think about with our middle schoolers, but it is a question that we've been asking since 2005 because it's an area of risk. And when we look at it, you can see that as young people age, the risk gets higher. And actually, our young men report becoming sexually active before our young women. Although, do the math a little bit there. this looks at lifetime prevalence of them reporting sexual intercourse and also condom use, and you can see how the two track together. The good news is that protection is involved, but you can see that overall the rates are going down in the right direction in terms of young people reporting being sexually active. And you can see the increase in 2009 was pretty significant, and it's dropping quite a bit. So we also ask at what age they became sexually active. This line of questioning is important for two reasons. One, to see where the level of risk is so that we can track prevention to the ages. And then also for young people to be able to disclose if there was possible sexual abuse. So when we look at this, only 6% reported that they were sexually active. And when we look into the finer details, actually 3% were younger than 8. So I think that's indicative of something to be concerned about, and that actually lines up with our police data and other data that we have around this particular issue. Gender differences. So again, these are just areas to kind of look at a little bit of a slice of the data. I think a couple things that's important to think about is where our young women might be reporting one area of risk behavior and our young men might be reporting another area, particularly for our young ladies, the receiving unwanted sexual comments or attention, I think is a concerning one. Depression, the difficulty concentrating, and then recent alcohol use and binge drinking. And also suicidal thoughts and planning is an area of concern for our young women. When we look at our young men, the physical fighting, the weapon carrying that we already talked about, and another area is being harassed because someone thought that they were gay, lesbian, or bisexual. So when we look at our diversity issues and looking at how to improve how young people treat each other, that's an area to consider, particularly for our young men. And then also, they have much higher rates of misuse of tobacco products and nicotine products. And nicotine products actually prime the brain for future drug use, so that's an area that we always want to keep an eye on. And then also, they were more likely to have had multiple sexual partners. So more likely to engage in sex younger, more likely to have multiple partners. So again, their risk slightly higher in that regard. And then also, one of the good areas was that they were already receiving treatment in the area of mental, emotional, or behavioral health. When I looked at the females from middle to high school, I thought it was interesting to think about, did things change or did they stay the same? And the areas of risk for our young ladies, at the middle school, they reported receiving unwanted sexual comments or attention. At the high school level, they reported a higher rate of sexual assault. So I think it's important to just keep in mind prevention, the issue around dating violence, sexual violence, and then also the area of non-suicidal self-injury comes out higher in our young ladies than it does in our young men, although their drug use is higher. We look at our young men, they reported, as I said, harassed because someone thought you were gay, lesbian, bisexual. At the high school level, they actually had a higher rate of injury from a suicide attempt. We look at prevention instruction by gender. It's interesting that they can be in the same class but perceive their prevention instruction to be different. So our young ladies reported that they received more bullying instruction, although they were given the same instruction, so it's perception. Less young ladies than our young men thought that they were receiving HIV/AIDS instruction, prevention, and less females than males reported receiving substance abuse prevention instruction. And then if we look at overall, bullying at 91% is the most significant area that they feel like they're receiving prevention instruction, followed by HIV, followed by substance abuse. So that's an area to look at as we look at building budgets, et cetera. And I've talked to you about kind of what AIRCASA provides in terms of technical assistance to the district, et cetera. And that brings us to questions. I'm happy to go back to any of the slides. This is
I was wondering if you could go back to slide 38.
Category?
It's the, I think.
Alcohol.
Alcohol reduction.
Tobacco. Alcohol, yeah. I just wanted to.
This one?
Yes. I think when we looked at this at the high school, you also talked about sort of the overlay of some policy training changes or maybe police approaches. I was just wondering if you could do that for us again so that to refresh my memory.
Sure. So in 2009, we began changing the town liquor policies. There were 19 changes to the town liquor policies. And then in 2011 and 12, the superintendent worked with the school committee to change the chemical health policies at the high school. And then also the police initiated their zero tolerance policy on underage drinking. And those efforts, we believe, really contributed significantly to the reduction, although the middle school didn't directly receive those, the intervention around the chemical health program, because it's geared to the high school level.
Well, with the exception of the application from the summer of starting eighth grade,
right,
that is applicable,
yep,
to the high school,
yes,
right,
activity.
Right. Yep.
So that was.
Yeah, so the expectation is put out there, and we do think it has a little bit of an effect there, but it's not the target audience. But an area to think about.
Right. You want to go to somebody else? Or
no,
I,
no, go
okay
ahead.
Slide 43.
Perception of parental disapproval?
Yes.
Yep.
So that is really concerning, but I have tried to have some frank talks with my own teenagers and some of their friends, and they look at these surveys. I think sometimes people look at the survey and they try to find the one question that's like just it couldn't be true, so the whole survey is not valid.
Mm-hmm.
But this one, that I wonder if that's related to them answering how they see their parents role modeling it, because if I tell them that it's not appropriate to be drinking every day, and especially they're underage, so it goes without saying, but even, you know, you're in college, I'm still paying the bills, you're 21, yes, you're legal, but I don't want you to drink every day. But yet if they see that you're having a glass of wine with dinner every day, you know, every evening or whatever, I think that's, I don't know, but I mean, maybe that's something we have to look into, is that role model message. And I can't remember the high school data. I know the high school data was upsetting on the marijuana piece and somewhat on the alcohol piece as you went up in grades. I think it's because they get more sophisticated and they watch your behavior. So, I don't know. We have to keep looking for, you know, what are the things that we can do as parents in addition to the, you know, school community.
And I do think it's an area where, you know, adults could make the argument. There's a lot of research regarding alcohol use, you know, being, particularly wine, can be good for the heart, and there's other things. And then there's also competing research that says, no, not so much. So there's a lot of different issues in adult alcohol use that can be a little confusing. So we want to make sure we don't mix that up with underage drinking, which we know can damage the brain, but also can set up a person for more likely to have dependency. So I do think it's important to be clear about the messages for adults versus teens, but I think the modeling piece comes in terms of coping. How is alcohol used to cope?
Mm-hmm.
Is it social? Is it recreational? Is it part of coping? And I think when we look at young people who misuse substances, it's often related to their ability to cope. So that's an area for parents to think about, how it's used in the home.
Thank you.
I had a question about early on you mentioned that there's less participation in middle schools than high schools in this survey. Is
yes.
that a trend you see increasing, or has it been pretty flat?
No, it's actually increasing.
Okay.
Yep.
So over time, hopefully more and more middle school.
And part of it is just funding. The Centers for Disease Control funds the survey for most of the schools in the country. Ours isn't one of those. But it's really about getting cooperation from districts to fund it at the middle school level. Because at the high school level, most states require it to be done, but not at the middle school level. So it's not a requirement.
Thank you. That's okay. When you referred to carrying weapons,
yes.
Is that any time, or is there a question about carrying them at school?
Carrying them at school. And we actually specify not for hunting, fishing, or other purposes like Boy Scouts, et cetera. So this would be a weapon for protection.
So that's, so those statistics are carrying at school?
Yes.
Okay, and then one of the last slides about the prevention instruction by gender.
Yeah.
And so they, do we in our curriculum teach them prevention on bullying, substance abuse, and HIV/AIDS?
On bullying, yes. There is a intervention related to that. On the two other areas, for the last few years, we've had the less of an opportunity to do the health education at that level. We did have a seventh grade health education program that was covering those two areas, but we don't have that right now as a funded program.
Can I follow up on that? So I was trying to remember the high school data on this. Did it display the same general trend?
No.
No. Okay.
It's between 80% and 96% for these three areas.
Oh, for the high school, where we're doing the training.
Yep.
Okay, but clearly if you, well, there's a small percentage of students, but in terms of sexual activity, we have to be getting that. We haven't been diligent as a society on that, and we have to, you know, be more diligent as a society and then figure out how we can get the funding we need to bring, you know, a high-quality, consistent, well-executed program. Because, you know, we made some decisions last year because we weren't going to be able to do that at the middle school level, and it would have been so fragmented that I think it wouldn't have achieved the goal. And none of us liked that decision, but so, you know, I think we have to really look at that. Maybe the media dialogue will actually become positive instead of just ridiculous on this.
I have a question on slide 15. There's really good news about the trusted adult to talk to, and you pointed out that that is such an important metric.
Yes.
What do you attribute that to? You know, on the alcohol use, we can point to some policy changes that appear to be having a positive impact. What do you think is happening that's creating a better connectedness?
There's been some really specific initiatives that the district has done, the individual schools have done, and it's been an area I know that has been on their radar screen for more than 10 years, but I think that it takes time to build the groundwork. I know it's an area over the last 3 years that's gotten even more attention in terms of, and I know if the superintendent can speak more to it, but I've observed a change as I look at how they function in terms of building that relationship, and it's a significant, it's a foundational aspect of what they do in the schools now.
We're using more tools to identify students that we feel are not connected, and then there are staff that specifically find a way to connect to those students. So I think that's why we're seeing that increase. And that's happened over the last 3 years.
It's wonderful to see that it's working. That's
great. I have a couple of things, and you just triggered me to think this. I think that having participated in Challenge Day, I think that that is one of the ways that students find out that adults are approachable, that adults have similar problems, and I felt that connection, and I know that it was part of the Challenge Day plan for adults to follow through with the students, and we met at the end of it to identify those students that we thought might need support. So I liked seeing these numbers. That was helpful. I had a couple of questions. One is the sample, it mentions at the beginning of the packet that we got, and you mentioned that the sample number in the middle school was lower.
For the nation?
No, I'm even thinking in our middle schools, there was a lower percentage of students that took this, that actually participated in the survey.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering, I know way back when it was sometimes because parents were reticent to have their children participate. I was wondering if you have a theory about why there are fewer students participating in the survey.
Sure. Overall, for 7th and 8th grade, participation has stayed about the same. We did see a drop in participation at the 6th grade level at one of our schools. A copy of a survey that was not ours was circulated amongst parents. It was actually a Canton survey that actually wasn't even their correct survey that referred to questions of a really specific sexual nature that parents were uncomfortable with. It's actually not a line of questioning that we ask. But that did have an impact, and I'm sure the principals could speak more to the specifics, but we did try to answer questions, offer our survey. We were asked to post the survey online. Unfortunately, we can't do that as part of our protocol because, again, people can end up seeing the wrong survey, so it gets tricky. But parents were offered the opportunity to look at the survey, to look at the rationale as to why we do ask questions. Some parents would prefer that we don't ask any sexual questions, and we understand the concern. But that's not something that we can take out of the survey at this point because it's part of our protocol.
I'm glad you're not thinking about taking it out, because I found it quite alarming that I was actually pleased, I guess, in a weird sort of way, that not as many kids were sexually active as I was afraid of, but that 50% of them don't use a condom was very frightening to me. And that's really important information for us as we go forward with our health education plans. So I'm glad that you keep it in. I put my vote on keeping it in. The other thing I just wanted to put my two cents worth in about was the bike helmets.
Yes.
And true to what Mrs. Webb was saying with the breakdown between role modeling, it's so often that I see parents riding with their kids and the kids are wearing the helmets sometimes and the parents aren't. And so I guess I have a personal bias towards this, just to plug that what we do, our kids copy, and that's really important. And I know that the middle schools have both the audio and the regular book of Mick Hart was here, and I'd love to see that used again. I don't know whether it is, but if the middle schools think it's, I just want to remind them they
okay.
have it.
Okay.
The other thing I wanted to ask you about was the jump. I was going back and forth between the numbers, between the report that you gave us and the report that we got on the high school. And I found it disturbing to see the jump in the high school from the middle school numbers to the high school around, hours of sleep goes way down.
Yeah.
But also the, taking a medicine for stress, difficulty concentrating, remembering, or making decisions, those kinds of questions, it's a lot. It jumps from the eighth grade, steadily increasing through senior year. And I was wondering if you could talk.
Yeah, I mean, what we know from the broader set of research is that it does increase significantly between eighth grade and coming up to the high school, but then also we see that jump from high school to college when we look at the college statistics, and then we see an even higher jump from college to adulthood. So it is actually a bigger societal question that I think is, it's one to grapple with. It really is. And if you look across the data, whether it's substance use, sexual risk-taking, stress, those particular areas definitely track as a person ages.
I think that issue, though, speaks to a comprehensive health program,
yes.
which we heard in community forums. We're hearing desire across the board for better, more comprehensive health curriculum. I mean, how much of that is teaching a kid? How many kids know how many hours of sleep they're supposed to be getting a night and explaining what it does to their brain? So I think it is something that could really fall into the category of health. And while I'm speaking, you had a couple of slides from 15 to 18. The stress of school and the anxiety around school,
yes.
and the fact that sixth graders were far less likely than eighth graders to say that they were getting mostly A's and B's, indicating a higher level of stress about their grades.
Yeah.
I found myself thinking about the MTSS from an academic standpoint. We've talked a lot about the multi-tiered system of supports for emotional and social, very important.
Yeah.
This to me speaks to the need for tier two academic interventions. So you've got kids who have significant needs, they're identified, they're federally mandated to get the support that they need. Then you got the kids who are cruising, just gonna make sure they're adequately challenged. I wonder, this makes me feel like tier two kids. The kids who are struggling and stressed, they're making it, but it's causing a tremendous amount of stress. And I wonder if you had some more academic supports for those kids, Could that have a positive impact on the stress that they're clearly feeling and the fear that they're feeling about success?
And I think as we start to share data with the staff, because you're seeing it first, you know, and then we'll begin doing the traveling show that we do and meeting with staff, and I think that this is going to be a question where all of the MTSS teams will have access to the data, and it will be helpful for them to really think about it in that bigger picture. We also have a number of after-school programs at Coolidge and at Parker, which actually do offer study supports, but sometimes parents really encourage their sixth graders to sign up for those because they want to make sure that they transition well and that they're getting a head start, but then you start to see drop-off enrollment-wise in seventh grade in those programs because they kind of have figured out the schools, quote-unquote, they think they've got it under control, but then sometimes the workload increases. So I think it's also a perception in terms of how we help young people have an easier way to ask for help, maybe, because I think sometimes it's hard for them to express that need. And I'm not saying that I think the schools are actually offering a lot of stuff, but getting them to partake of it is a bit of a challenge. And I know a lot of teachers do some amazing things about having lots of open time in the morning and in the afternoon so that students can feel like they can come in and out. And I think that is also an area where young people do access support. And I'm not sure if the principals want to speak to any of that.
No, it's true. We have a lot to offer. And that, you know, even looking at the 6th, 7th, 8th grade, it was interesting to me that perception of grades there in the 6th grade. I've been thinking about that as we sit here. I think there's so much anxiety for kids to come into 6th grade and getting those grades for the first time now that they don't have any grades in elementary and wanting to really work so hard to feel successful, and they take advantage of a lot of supports in 6th grade, and there are a lot of teachers are staying before or after, you know, so they are really taking advantage, but I still feel like there's that anxiety of transition that's so strong in the 6th grade, and then they finally kind of catch on, and then I think 7th, the supports are different, and then there's a more social aspect that I think starts to play into it, and they have more of that, well, am I going to come in earlier? Am I going to be seen late? And a lot of kids do still take advantage of it. But I think more of that social pressure comes into it. What am I doing after school? A lot of kids are hanging out instead or doing things together. And I think sports are prevalent, you know, that they're being drawn in other directions. So I think the stresses shift a little bit, but there still are a lot of supports. I agree with what you were saying earlier about those tier two supports. I think during the school day, you know, there aren't as many. And I know that's something that we've talked about, too, as a school. Like, how do we help kids during the school day, too, to get the resources and the support they need, even if they aren't on an IEP, right?
Yeah, I think that's probably very important, too, because of what we're hearing about them being overbooked.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. Heading so to piano important. Lessons or, yeah, football or whatever, yeah.
I think we've been talking about also slide 17 here, that graph. And I was, you know, I know we've talked a lot about this, and I think, you know, there's been a lot of dialogue about, like you said, extracurricular, social pressure, sleep. And then when you look at sort of the family, the parent, the schedule, you know, there's a lot of things that I think we have to recognize that we as the parent can be in a little bit more control of, at the least, hopefully at the middle school age, for our young teens. And again, you know, I know John's been looking at districts, been talking about, you know, how do we look at the school schedule itself to maybe address that. But I was just pretty struck by, you know, when you put those together, right? The schedule and the family demands. That's a pretty big chunk. So happy to see that some of the other things were lower, but surprised at that.
I think one of the other things is how we perceive expectations and a busy schedule. Someone commented to me recently that we use busy as a feeling now. So if someone asks how you're doing, you say busy. And, you know, busy is not really a feeling. But it's become part of our vernacular that busy equals we're productive. Mm-hmm. And that can be good, but it also may leave little room for young people to feel like downtime is a good thing. So it's just something to kind of keep in mind as we have this conversation. I know the conversation's been happening in many ways around the MTSS work, but I think it's also that bigger question around productivity versus the ability to have a little bit of that downtime. And I know in our elementary level, they've been building in a lot of mini things like refreshers in the classroom and yoga in the classroom and some other things, just little pockets of moments where you can kind of de-stress a little bit. And I think it's just something to keep in mind. It's maybe not a massive intervention, it's little steps, you know, in how we do things.
I have one more slide, 41. And I think I was so moved by Dr. Hill's presentation here a few weeks ago and reading his book on marijuana and, you know, the myths about the world's most popular weed. And although this is only 8%, 17%, according to the data, 17% of that 8% stand a chance of becoming addicted to marijuana. And it does, you know, it, like the other substances, these are brain-altering, mind-altering, and it's, the kids think it's most, the high school data shows they all think it's safer than alcohol, and you could argue that it is in some respects. But I think we just have to really, you know, as a community and as a culture and really at the state level with everything that's going on, we need to really look at that. Because we don't want to walk away. We can't just sit here and say, well, I'm pretty satisfied because at least 92% of our kids, it's not like maybe some other districts that might be worse. But are we going to sit here and say, you know, we don't. Not for any slice of a pie. We have to remember that those are individual kids and the risk of addiction and then the subsequent trauma and issues resultant from addiction for young people, that rate is, it's almost twice as high. Yeah, it's about twice as high as for, I think, people 25 and older after your brain is already developed. And I guess, you know, after
it,
that.
It also, I mean, for me, it raises the question, regardless of what substance they're using, why are they using it? Because we use substances to change how we feel. And particularly with marijuana, the research shows that young people often self-medicate with marijuana, particularly if they're struggling with mental health issues, but it may be something that's undiagnosed. And there's research that relates to bipolar disorder and some of the other mood disorders that really directly connect to young people seeking out a drug like marijuana because it relaxes the body. And so it can have an effect that young people can feel like is calming on them, although for some young people it can create more paranoia and more anxiety. So it's an area to think about, not just for how many young people are using it, but why they're using it. Mm-hmm. And that's a question I think we're having as a community and we continue to have. And regardless of the debate on what's happening with marijuana, why are young people using it is a very important question.
So that would lead into, there's something going on December 3rd.
Yes.
Yeah, maybe Eric can highlight that.
December 3rd, Senator Lewis is hosting a opioid forum, a conversation for the community to have. He's gonna provide an update on what the progress is at the state level on what the work we've been doing on opioid prevention, as well as I'll be there to share our local progress, and we'll have some regional results, and there'll be two folks from the state level to talk about upcoming initiatives. It's focused on opioid issues, but when we break it down to the micro level at the middle school level, you're not seeing the opioid level yet, but this is the precursor to the next level. So important for folks to come out, regardless of how old your children are.
And that's here.
That's here December 3rd, Performing Arts Center, 6 p.m. December 3rd. Did I miss any questions?
I have a quick one.
Sure.
I think I really appreciated that you started your presentation by pointing out that the vast majority of kids are healthy and making good choices and safe. So that's reassuring. But to Mrs. Webb's point, the little numbers are terrifying and
yes.
Heartbreaking. If a student identifies on an anonymous survey that they have been inappropriately involved sexually, obviously someone 8 years old is inappropriate and illegal and criminal, or suicidality, very, very dangerous stuff. Is there any follow-up after the survey? Obviously, you don't know which kids, but any education to say, if you are struggling with these areas, here's what you should do about it. Could you speak to that a little bit?
Sure. Our folks at both middle schools are aware of when the survey is happening, and they do say that sometimes they'll see folks seeking help or coming in related to that. Not always. We also see an uptick after presentations that relate to the subject. We also did a training 3 years ago for our staff on identifying possible victims of sexual assault, particularly in around children. So it's also something that we're working with our adults to really identify and provide support. Mental health first aid also goes over those signs and symptoms. And although the survey is anonymous, they have really trusted relationships with their educators that are actually administering the survey. And I know that they provide a great deal of support for any young person that that.
I just wanted to make
One minute, Mrs. Lieberman.
Sorry.
Were there any more committee questions? All right, go right ahead.
I just wanted to let folks know the Wakefield has developed a great relationship between their public health commission, their school nursing staff, and psychologists, and they have put together a suicide prevention program in the schools. You probably know facts about suicide. It's highly linked to substance abuse, self-medication. So the increase in substance abuse in high school is alarming, and it's going to be linked to suicide attempts. And if it's possible to pick their brain and see what they did and how they did it, it was wonderful. They were out there at the Out of the Darkness Walk in September, and they have a fantastic program. And I also happen to work at Department of Public Health, and they have a unit there, and they've worked closely with the Massachusetts Department of Public Health on this issue. So that's a resource for you guys, and we don't have to reinvent the wheel. We should see if we could bring something like that to Reading. It would be amazing.
Thank you so much for that feedback.
Thank you so much. One of the things that, as you know, I've talked about our regional collaboration, which involves Wakefield. We meet every 2 weeks with Wakefield, Melrose, Malden, Stoneham, and Medford, and we exchange resources. And one of the resources that we've just have been in the process of building is a matrix of what each district is offering so that we can exchange and share. And we just did a rundown of all of our support services, all of our health education programs, and that resource is going to be shared amongst not just our group, but across the broader state. What we find is that Wakefield is borrowing from Reading in some areas, and we're looking to borrow from them. Stoneham has just started their coalition in the last 2 years, so there's a lot of cross-collaboration, and Wakefield's a huge resource for us as well. And we also learned about youth mental health first aid from Wakefield initially, so they've been a good source of inspiration for us.
And they pay in to a service that
yes.
provides resources for emergency help, which is something we might want to think about if our problem really keeps growing or saves lives.
Thank you. And that's something we can talk about more as we give you updates on the regional collaboration. There's some different districts are using different resources around accessing appointments for psychotherapy.
That would be great. Do we have any other questions for Ms. McNamara? Thank you so much for being here tonight. That was a very thorough presentation.
Thank you.
Mr. Martin, are you ready? Okay. Up next, Assistant Superintendent Craig Martin is going to give us a presentation, our annual, very important presentation on how our students did on the statewide assessment last spring.
First received our MCAS scores, and then very recently we received our scores from PARC, and at that time we released all of the information and some comprehensive tables that we put together to you all and to the public. My goal tonight is to kind of do sort of a quick overview of that at the district level, but also kind of to explore some comparisons from year to year, also some of the other important areas that we tend to look at each year to sort of monitor our progress and improvement along the way. So as I said, we received the MCAS scores. This last year, our students still took the MCAS assessment in grades 5, 8, and 9 in science. And then the high school continued with the MCAS in grades 10 in ELA, English Language Arts, and math. And then, as you know, last year we administered the PARC in the spring in grades 3 through 8 for mathematics, grades 3 through 8 ELA literacy, and then also grade 8 math, which was, we had the option of doing their grade 8 Algebra 1, which Reading also administered. I mean, as you know, last year's 10th graders represented the first group of high school students to take the MCAS test since we started realigning our curriculum to the state's new frameworks. And so we've been very eager to see those results, and so we'll take a look at those as well. As we do every year, whatever the assessment is, we are eager to get the results. We use them to see how we're doing. We look at the overall student groups, the subgroups, individual schools, to see, to make sure that our curriculum is aligned We're also looking at instructional practices, even individual students, not just subgroups, but even individual students that might need supports along the way. You're familiar already with the MCAS performance levels based on their scaled scores ranging from warning, needs improvement, proficient, advanced. So I thought we'd start with the MCAS. This is grade 5 science, and the way these series of slides are arranged, each color is a year, so we're looking at 4 years here in each category. Okay, so 2012, 13, 14, and 15. To kind of put it in the context of the years, the last column to the right then represents advanced and proficient together. Okay. This is our grade 8 science and technology, arranged the same way. Overall, as we look at this, especially compared to our science results, this is an area that we've already indicated that we're looking at our vertical alignment and also the need to update our science curriculum, that really needs to continue as a priority, especially at our elementary and middle level. And that has begun this year in elementary, and we're looking and hoping to continue that. These are our results for the high school science through the years. You can see a pretty significant jump there. This year's science results at the high school, we have 84% of the high school students scoring in the proficient or advanced range. Staying with the high school here now, we're switching over to English language arts. Here, this year, 98% of our high school students scored in the proficient or advanced range, which is actually the highest percentage scoring at that level, or at the advanced level, which is 69%, since the state began MCAS testing, which was 1998. We really like to see that jump from proficient to advanced is really something that we feel our community, especially at high school, should be focusing on. Similar slide for high school mathematics. This year in math, 92% of the Reading High School students scored proficient and advanced, and now 74% of those are at the advanced level. You can see both of those represent a jump from the previous year. Switching over then to the PARC results that we've received, and this is the way the PARC achievement levels are that have been scored. Unlike MCAS, there's no level called proficient, but level 4 represents the point at which students have met expectations. So it goes from level 1, not meeting expectations as of yet, partially meeting expectations, level 2, approaching expectations, meeting expectations, or exceeding expectations. Actually sort of mirrored in many ways are the elementary report card. So PARC is scored on those 5 achievement levels. So we're going to take a quick look. We'll start with English language arts at each grade level. The state had been indicating that across the board, they felt that many of the grade levels would see somewhat of a drop overall in our achievement levels, with PARC being a more rigorous assessment. So I want to quickly look through each level, and then I want to do a comparison of the years and how we are comparing with the state. So this is grade 3 English language arts. So it goes this way, starting with level 1, the percent of students at level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4, level 5, which is the exceeding, and then sort of the bright royal blue column there is 4 and 5, which is meeting or exceeding, which I'm saying is roughly analogous to meeting or proficient or advanced. There's grade 4 English language arts, arranged the same way. You see there we have 70% meeting or exceeding. Grade 5, going up to about 75%. Grade 6, about the same, a little bit higher, I think it was about 76%. Grade 7 is around 81%. meeting or exceeding. And grade 8, about 74, I believe it was. So this is an overview of 3 through 8 together. And the state provides us this sort of, if we took them all cumulatively, we had right over 70% of those students meet or exceed. And then I thought we wanted to take a look at how we're comparing with the MCAS scores that we've had in the past relative to how we've scored compared to the state averages. It's sort of hard to do. You know, as the state has said, MCAS was originally designed to measure students' knowledge of the key concepts and curriculum material that aligned with their state framework. And achievement levels were set to establish a proficiency level for high school graduation. Whereas the new generation assessments are now being developed to measure college and career readiness and really to focus on the students' reasoning or their ability to apply concepts, which is essentially the bar is being put at a different place. So in some ways it's a difficult comparison to make because you're really looking at two different things. One of the things I was very interested in, and some of our educators are very interested in, is not so much the actual achievement level that we hit, but how we're looking at compared the sort of the difference, that delta between where we were scoring with the state average. So I thought that might be interesting to look at. We've been looking at that the last week or so overall. So for instance, here in the blue is 2012. This is where grade 3 English Language Arts was scoring on the MCAS compared to the state averages in that year. So if you look at that for the last 3 years of MCAS, and then there's the comparison of where our third graders scored in English Language Arts in Park compared to the state averages for Park that year, or this year, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
There's no question, and we'll see it probably even a little more so in math, that we've identified the third grade as something we really want to examine those results more across the board. And really that's looking at K through 3, not just third grade, to make sure that everything is aligned, that we're doing well. And we'll be looking not just at our own results, but also all the released items from the assessments to make sure that we're hitting things when we need to be. Grade 4 is set up the same way. You can see there, like, to compare our achievement with our fourth graders on MCAS. It was interesting that not only the achievement level was a little higher, but the difference between Reading's achievement results and the state averages was actually a little bit of a wider gap. So we were pleased with that this first time around. Fifth grade. Grade 6 ELA. Again, we were expecting a drop, and we kind of see, although the gap is a little bit larger between us and the state average, but both did go down. Grade 7 ELA, actually one of the larger differentials there between our achievement levels and the state average. And grade 8, English Language Arts. Overall, as we look at ELA in grades 3 through 8, the percentage of Reading students who met or exceeded expectations were overall 12 points higher than the state average. Well, this isn't the Park, obviously it's the MCAS, but I thought I'd show a similar slide of how it's looked year to year for the mm-hmm. ELA MCAS at the high school. Fairly consistent there. So I'd like to do the same thing with mathematics, starting with grade 3. Again, it's showing each achievement level, and then the bright blue represents meeting and exceeding together, level 4 and 5 together. Right there, it's 60%. Grade 4, right above 60%. Grade 5, grade 6, right over 70%. 5%. Grade 8. And then this year, districts had the option of administering their Algebra 1 assessment to students who are in Algebra 1. And we were very pleased that 100% of the students either met or exceeded expectations, which was 20% higher than the state average. So any student that is enrolled in Algebra 1 in eighth grade met or exceeded the expectations. Again, looking at grades 3 through 8 together, about 65% of the students overall in those grades together for scoring or meeting or exceeding expectations. So again, I'm doing the same thing as we did with English Language Arts. We were interested in comparing sort of our achievement level scores with the state averages over the years, starting with 2012, 13, and 14. You can see here in grade 3 math, definitely both the state and our achievement levels went down. The differential was a little bit larger than it was last year. So obviously still not where we wanted. As I said before, this was an area that we felt we were closer to the state average. In some areas, as we look at some the subdata, even below we're at, and so that's something we're looking at more and more. Grade 4, though, we actually see a spike upwards. Fairly significant difference to the state average in that one. Grade 5. Grade 6. Grade 7. And grade 8. Again, as we look at grades 3 through 8 together, the percentage of students in Reading that met or exceeded were 13 points higher than the state average. 3 through 8 together. And again, for the high school, jumping back to MCAS, just to sort of see the trend there. Again, fairly consistent year to year. Another area that we look at very closely each year is the growth. The assessment scores indicate how each student is achieving relative to the standards in that grade level, which is obviously very important. But one of the things that's very important to us as educators, because that group, you know, when you're looking at how did fourth grade do this year compared to fourth grade did last year, we're looking at different groups of students, so there's some other variables in there. So it's very important to us to look at how did individual students as well as those groups of students do, the same students do from one year to the next. Okay, and that's exactly what it's saying here. Growth indicates a change in an individual student's progress from one year to the next. For example, how much did Mary improve in math from fifth grade to sixth grade? How did Mary improve any more or less than her academic peers or students who had similar scores in the previous years? The state calls that the student growth percentiles, which they started factoring in several years ago. This is how they define it. And the state defines moderate growth, or the growth that you would expect to see in a year, between the 40th and 60th percentile. Low growth is below the 40th percentile, and then high growth obviously is above the 60th percentile. So again, if we're looking at Mary and how she's improved from fifth grade to sixth grade relative to her peers. The example of how it's expressed in the percentile, if Mary improved more than 65% of her academic peers, her peers who scored similarly to her in the past, her student growth percentile, or SGP as they call it, would be a 65. Mm-hmm. So we said it's very important to look at this because it's very different from achievement. Every student, regardless of how they're scoring, can actually show significant growth. Okay, whether you're a high achiever or a low achiever. And it's growth is subject to grade, subject, and year specific. It can differ. The same student could have a different SGP in one content area than he or she had in another area. It's also very important, as I've sort of already implied, because it shows that even students who are struggling, and we might know as educators, our goal obviously is to get them over that bar at some point, but we might know in that given year they're not yet going to make it, but we absolutely want to make sure that they're making at least a good solid year or more's worth of progress. In the same way, students who have already cleared that bar, you know, another type of challenge, that they've cleared that bar, they're actually excelling, how can they continue to make growth as a student? And so we look at those every year. This is a table that we've been using the last couple of years to sort of compare. Basically, it takes all of the SGPs that are available to us by grade level and subject areas in ELA and math, and this is the median SGP for the school district at that grade level. When I started filling in the 2015 column, I was pleased to see that 11 of the 12 median SGPs this year increased, several significantly from last year. And all of those median SGPs this year are in the moderate to high growth range. 40 to 60 is moderate, and actually half of those are in the high growth range, which is a significant thing to note, I believe. This is also in terms of the math at the high school. I should note that it's the largest percentage of high school students individually that received moderate to high growth. 64% of the students actually fell into that category this year, resulting in the highest median SGP for high school math since the state began administering MCAS. Actually, because for years now we've been getting pretty good achievement scores in that. That's actually significant because you're growing at the higher end of the ceiling there. So another way to kind of look at these results too, I love these sort of quadrants. So let me explain this, and the state has used these, and I sort of put it together there by grade level. So essentially the way that this is working is that this is the median student growth percentile, and you're from 0 to 100. So we've got 40 to 60, so that column right there in the middle would represent the moderate growth, okay? And then on this other axis, you've got the percent proficient or higher. So that is actually the achievement levels. So obviously with that, with the cross lines here, this is the quadrant we'd want to end up on. So over this 50 mark here would be the higher growth or higher achievement, and over to the right side would be the higher growth. And so up and to the right is where we would want to be. The larger circle there is the high school. And then each one of the different colors, green is grade 4, purple is grade 5, orange is grade 6, red is grade 7, and the kind of pinkish color, it's not showing up too well in the projector there, is grade 8. But we're pleased the high school, because they are actually kind of hitting the ceiling in achievement. It's hard to get the growth, but they're still pretty solidly in the moderate growth, and the rest are to the right. This is English language arts by grade. When you look at math, when I started putting those dots on there, it was great for me to see that they were all very clearly in that upper right quadrant of both higher achievement and higher growth. Another area that we look at every year are our subgroups, especially our high-need subgroup, and for Reading, the largest percentage of students in that subgroup are students with disabilities. We look at that because we want to see how much of a gap there is, how much differential is there, not only in their achievements, but also the growth, to see are those students progressing at the same rate, same progress as our aggregate group. There's no question, as a note here that I put, that while generally I could say that we're pleased with the aggregate group, the all students group, in the progress that we've seen in the last year, We still are disaggregating that data because we have some concerns about our subgroups. It's not unique to Reading, but that's clearly an area that I think that we have some work to do, especially our students with disabilities. You can see here, I mean, I've got 2013 and 2014. This is actually the achievement, the percent either proficient or advanced. And this is the high needs group compared to the all student group. Okay. So this is showing what it was in 2013 for MCAS, 2014 for MCAS, grade 10 MCAS for the high school this year, and then grades 3 through 8 through Park. So I broke those up because it was really difficult to try to put those together. Overall, if I show the difference between 3 through 8 and high school traditionally, we'd see a similar jump that the students tend to spike up quite a bit by high school, but there's a gap there that needs addressing. Fairly significant, as you can see, even here in math. And I think it's a little more pronounced in math. As I look at the math median SGPs, makes me a little more optimistic, because we can see, even though we're not pleased with the achievement levels, the students still seem to be progressing in that moderate growth range. So this is comparing the high needs growth group with the all students group. Again, you'd want to see students at least in the 40 to 60th percentile for SGP. Obviously here in 2015, we're seeing a little bit more pronounced gap. Jumping over to ELA and looking at the same thing, again going back to the achievement levels, the percentage of students that are proficient or advanced in MCAS were level 4 and 5 in PARC by each year. You can see there in 2015, if I look at grades 3 through 8 together, a really significant gap there that we need to address. Again, as I look at the growth, though, the students are continuing to grow. We just have to put strategies in place to accelerate that growth even more, because the gap is larger. So moving forward, several thoughts. As I said, we continue to use this data to see how we're doing in all areas, to examine our curriculum, our instructional methods, see what we're strong at, where our weaknesses are. And we're looking to improve all of the content areas and grade levels, including math, ELA, and science. The news came out, I guess it was last week, and I think we sent something out, but just to sort of echo it here, the Massachusetts Board of Education voted last week to develop the next generation state assessment, which I think is tentatively being called MCAS 2.0. We'll see if that remains in terms of the name of it, for spring of 2017. Some important details then of how that impacts us in Reading, that the Reading Public Schools will continue with the PARC online assessment in 2016 for grades 3 through 8, English, Language Arts, and Math. MCAS will continue to be administered at the high school for the next 2 years to the class of 2019. Schools that take PARC in 2016 will continue to be held harmless for accountability determination, and all schools in the Commonwealth will also be held harmless for the first year's administration of the new assessment in 2017. Essentially, what that means is that the accountability levels may stay the same or improve during this transitional time, but they cannot decline. But the DESE has announced that it will still be releasing the full comprehensive accountability reports with all the data publicly for all the districts. So we still look forward to seeing all that getting all that information and making adjustments as we need to go along. And the state finally here is reporting that all schools will take the 2019 Massachusetts assessment online. You know, some additional thoughts here. The DESE has been reporting for some time that they expect that student achievement may appear lower in some grade levels with the park because it was a much more rigorous assessment in their view. But as all of our staff has been working really hard the last couple of years to align our instructional methods, our curriculum to the state's new standards, we have been eager to see this data. And while there's no question that we still have a way to go, I think our staff, it's clear that the staff has been doing great work in that area. I just want to make a reference to the handout that you have, the composite performance index, which without getting into too many details about how the accountability formula works, because that's yet to be released, but we're starting to look at that as a district. The CPI, as they call it, measures the extent to which groups, the district, the large group, the school groups, the subgroups, all are progressing toward full proficiency. The accountability formula, the way the state has it, it looks at the last 4 years. And overall, all groups are expected to be having the distance between their level of performance in 2011 to proficiency by 2017. Okay. So when we look at those CPIs, I saw that 32 of the 41 CPIs that we've had in all the different areas of all the different schools and different content areas, 32 of them represent an improvement over the previous year, which I think is certainly a good sign. As we continue to monitor and address the accountability status, I think it should be noted that several of those CPI increases actually occurred at the Joshua Eaton Elementary School, including three rather significant increases. And that includes fourth and fifth grade math as well as in science. Again, it's not the entire puzzle, but it's a step in the right direction. So I applaud the staff for their work there. The DESE has indicated also that individual student reports for PARC are being shipped to the districts, to us, by the end of this month. We're anticipating that we'll be able to get those in the mail out to the families and to their homes in the beginning of December if we get everything on time. Each school then is also scheduling their own evening meetings coming up, starting at the beginning of December, so I think as soon as we get back from the Thanksgiving break, where they will actually examine their own individual school data. And then I've also included here, because we'll post this presentation online, links that can bring people right directly to the individual data for each school level if they want to look at the results for their own school and see how they compare to the state, the rest of the district, and so forth. That brings us to questions.
I have a question. So it's mostly around slide, 50. The
50, you said?
Sorry?
Yep.
So the students, trying to figure out which year, but they will have taken PARC and done the online assessment, and then they basically go back, will end up sort of taking an MCAS paper assessment. Is that true? And because of the timing, or will the MCAS 2.0?
They won't be taking PARC in eighth.
No, the current ninth grade.
Yeah.
Is going to continue to take MCAS. So ninth and tenth grade.
Okay. Ninth grade graduates in 2019.
Okay, so they won't really go backwards. Any of the students who have had the opportunity who take the PARC in grades 3 through 8. That's what I'm trying to understand. Do they end up sort of at
The current ninth grade would have taken the PARC last year, but they'll be taking the MCAS in 9 and 10.
Okay.
The science in ninth and.
So if that's what you mean, there are a couple.
Yeah,
years
I mean,
when they get to high school.
I'm under the impression that most of the feedback that I heard, and I mean, from maybe here, maybe just other students, was fairly positive about, at least at the high school level, about the PARC, not at the high school level, at the middle school level, about the PARC as an online assessment. And I'm just sort of shocked that the state would say, even though PARC is an online tool now in 2015, it's gonna take us 4 more years to get MCAS 2.0 to be online.
No, that's for the entire state.
Right.
That's the entire state to take it. It will not be a paper version after 2019.
Right, but you could take the PARC online now. I'm just sort of.
Some districts can't.
Okay.
But
But I
think this is also saying to the districts to be sure that we're ready by 2019.
Yeah.
And I think
to take an online assessment.
Be able to take it online.
Okay.
I mean, one of the things that, I mean, as educators, we've been looking forward to that, because ideally it's not happening this year necessarily, but as they actually unroll all this, that we're able to get the results back
right,
in a much faster time and almost use it formatively.
Right, that's been one of the biggest
months and months to get it back.
Issues, I think, that
just add to that.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, because I think I'm confused. So in the spring of 2017, when we do MCAS 2.0, is that online or on paper?
Online. Well, it'll be a choice by a district.
Okay, and we'll be online. Okay.
Oh, okay. All right. I was missing that point. I thought the MCAS 2.0 was coming out as a paper instrument
in
2017.
No.
Thank goodness. No, we've been just, I mean, this has been so many years.
That. I think by this time, there's no longer a choice. Is that
it's
oh,
no longer
I
a choice
see. Okay.
In 2019.
So, I mean, obviously, we'll have several years of experience with PARC as an online instrument at all the other grades, and the high school won't be an issue at all, I don't think. But okay, thank you. Yeah, I think that's so important that we just haven't had the ability to, you know, gain access to the data until long after the students have left the grade level. So that's, I think, one of the great things about, you know, this format.
I actually have a question about access to the data. It looked to me online that PARC has released the tests, the test questions.
They've released a number of questions, as the state had done for MCAS in the past. And so I don't think it's all of them, but it is it's a portion of them.
Yeah,
yes. Yeah.
It's a pretty good portion. So I would just encourage parents who are interested, because I did. I was interested in what test did my child take. And it is very, very educating to look at an MCAS and look at the PARC, because they are very different tests.
I think in one of the announcements that I sent out, I included a link to the released items that
it might have been
parents could, yeah.
But it really,
yeah, no,
I mean, you can see that the standard is the same. If you look at a third grade, which is what I looked at, a third grade math, MCAS or PARC, you can see it's the same standard, but the level of detail and the challenge is definitely harder in the PARC, no doubt about it.
I think to follow up on that and kind of the lower results with the third grade PARC, do we think that is because the way the test was administered and the third graders are having it's a little bit more challenging for them to take the test online?
That could be part of it. You know, we've talked about that it's the first time that they're taking this type of assessment, but that's where still, I mean, maybe in another month or so I'll have a better answer. We're also looking at our curriculum topics to make sure. I mean, we're still looking at that. I don't have the firm answer, but
that in mind, maybe starting in the earlier grades, get those computer skills, you know, just a little bit more familiarity.
Yeah, you know, one of the things that we're seeing too, in like take math especially, for instance, that even students that could be very comfortable with the screen, and many students even the younger students indicated that they are, it's sort of that dual modality sort of thing that, you know, the older students are much more comfortable saying they're not mesmerized by the screen, they're actually still using paper and pencil and figuring and doing it and then going to the computer. I don't know if that's part of it, but it could be. But we'll be looking at that. Yeah.
I just wanted, first of all, to say thank you. This was a very helpful presentation for me. Going through all the data, I have to admit I was struggling with some of the comparisons over time, because the test it's not the same test. And so the way you've captured it here is very helpful to me. So thank you very much. Also, in terms of the questions that were asked about going online, I think we were very lucky in Reading, because our administration planned ahead of time and asked the town for funds in order to get enough technology equipment here so that we had time to get up to speed on the technology, to have enough machines. And I've heard from other communities that they haven't had that opportunity, and therefore there is that option still of paper. So I think that's really a reflection on Reading. And I was not on the school committee then, but I'm very grateful that the administration and the school committee planned ahead that way. I had a question at the Mass conference, the Mass Association of School Committees conference that I was just at. I went to a workshop on cultural proficiency, and one of the things that they said, first of all, they have a thing about groups versus subgroups. They don't like calling them subgroups. because it marginalizes and sets people apart. So they were talking, you were talking about disaggregating data for different groups, and you had a special interest, we have a special interest in the special ed, but they also were highlighting that we ought to disaggregate the data for other groups as well, both those that are doing well, so that we can highlight the teachers that might be using best practices that we want to emulate and share in our PLCs, but also for those that aren't working. And I know that there are discussions going on in terms of the AP classes and trying to get different groups access to those. So I'm just wondering if you can say a little bit about what other groups you're looking at and in terms of the data that yeah. we've got.
No, I agree. I mean, I've always been a little uncomfortable with that terminology of subgroup, but essentially whatever we have the data for, we're looking at those groups. You know, gender, ethnicity, disabilities, all the different categories of high needs, anything that the state has separated the data, then absolutely. And then staff are looking at different, you know, the different buildings, the different classrooms, especially as we've been in a transition. You know, it's not as if we're presenting that and talking about that publicly, but even the things that we have, that, you know, not only are we shifting our instructional methods and our curriculum, but even the structures that we've put in place in the last couple of years about how we do this work very collaboratively, I think is creating a much more comfortable space for staff to do that examination, you know, in a safe, comfortable way with just the expectation it's what we do, right? That that's how we make sure that we're making that we provide for students the same access to success, and that we're sharing each other's strengths. And I think that's going to get stronger and stronger.
I'd like to switch gears a little bit to science and technology. You hit on this when you looked a little bit at slides 4, 5, and 6, but when I look at the grade 9-10 science, you know, the advanced, this is slide 6, the advanced proficient lines are fairly consistent. It's up or down a little bit every year, but fairly consistent. But if you look at just the proficient and the advanced, you're actually seeing a slight decline in proficient and an increase in advanced, which is what you want. So they're doing well, but you're seeing more kids shift to advanced. If I go back 2 slides to the grade 5, you see the exact reverse. So if you just look at the 4 and 5, advanced and proficient, you know, it looks good, and it's actually up this year. But what concerns me is the numbers of advance are going down while the proficiency is going up. So can you speak to what's going on in grade 5 versus grade 9 and 10 science? Do you have a theory as to why that is looks better in grade 9 and 10 and the results are good, but a little bit concerning in grade 5?
Yeah, I mean, a couple quick thoughts. I mean, one is that the high school science test tends to focus on one subject area, which is biology. Whereas the other two tests that we're looking at, elementary and middle, is sort of a cumulative, just over the last few years. So that's a little bit different ballgame right there. And then the other factor that quickly comes to mind, which I've already mentioned, is I think a need for us to update and align our curriculum materials and things at the elementary and middle level. We're starting to look at that, and then the state started talking about adjusting the standards, the next generation science standards and so forth. And so it seemed prudent to sort of wait before we did a lot of work and made investments in that. But it's now we've hit that time, so we've begun that work.
Yeah, I think I agree with you. I think these results speak to that need.
Yep,
yes. Yes.
So I just on that subject, I mean, I think part of that too has to do with this is an area that we've known we've needed to put resources into for a long time. I think I might be going back like 15 years, but. You know, there was a time when the district would have taken on a curriculum change without ensuring that you had sort of the 3-year resource plan and the 3-year commitment. And again, maybe I'm going back more than 15 years, but we did that at least twice that I remember. And it just creates, it's just such a failure on so many fronts, and especially, you know, for the teachers, you know, the communication that sends to them that, you know, we're not committed and they put in all this work and then we just don't support it. So I think for me, one of the difficult things about being on the committee over, I don't even know what, but since 2003 on and off here, is that we just haven't been able to commit to the three-year, you know, curriculum development. So in addition to the fact that there's been some change, in my mind, that just gave us an ability to say, well, you know, this, we don't have the resources. We're not going to fund that. We can't fund that right now because we haven't committed the resources. And also, they're making this change. And I just want to say that I commend, really, the district and Principal Marchant. When this came out, the letter specifically to the Coolidge community, I thought was just so thoughtful and so well done. And I thought to myself, like, I know, I really feel like, and I know, and I'm part of the problem because I didn't stand up strong enough on the committee to say, you know, we need the money to do this. That you at no time basically used as an excuse that we didn't fund curriculum improvement. And in reality, it is part of, you know, something that underlies this. So I think, you know, we as a community have to find a way to make that solid three-year commitment. We can't, this is proof, we know we can't Band-Aid new curriculum implementations. So I'm glad that our district doesn't do that anymore, but it's meant that we've really put this off. And I have one other, just really quick.
Speak to that piece? Because I think it's important that you understand it's more than a three-year commitment. So there's two phases.
Okay.
Science is a very funding-intensive subject,
mm-hmm.
because you have
equipment.
Durables that you need to purchase, and then you have consumables that are going to be an ongoing purchase. So we agree, you know, the first 3 years to get the durables
mm-hmm.
to a point, so that it, whatever curriculum is programmed or is being done is going to need to be purchased and a phase in.
Right.
But then the consumable piece is going to be an ongoing cost that you have to do. You know, the STC kits that we've had for probably 25 years now is a perfect example. You know, we purchased those kits long ago, but it's the ongoing consumable piece that you need to keep up.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's important on saying it's a two-part process.
Right.
The other theme, just to add to that, that's sort of been a primary theme, I feel, in my role and as a district, and that's just been our capacity. Mm-hmm. That even goes beyond you know, financial resources for curriculum, but it's personnel. It's just how many things can be done at the same time. I mean, that we don't necessarily have all of the structures and things. That's why we've really worked hard, I think, to, you know, I've said to staff, we can't work harder, but maybe we can work smarter. We can work in different ways. You know, there's no question in my mind that all of the things that are happening in, you know, the shift in standards in ELA and math and science is long overdue and in the benefit of kids. But it also means that how many things can you all do at the same time? And so I think that there's also some strategy in that, that, you know, how you implement things, not only budgetarily talking, but also just in terms of how staff, like, you know, I think of the K through 4 or K through 3 teacher that's teaching all of those subjects. Well, how many do? So how you roll things out, how you do it in a way. You know, I say to staff that the end point in my mind isn't necessarily implementation. The end point is getting positive results, getting positive student outcomes. And I think sometimes as districts implement things in a certain way, you can actually extend that longer than you want to because of the way you've implemented, by you've just, you know, kind of crashed your capacity. So I think we're trying to be very strategic to try to make sure that that timeline to the positive student outcomes is as absolutely as short as possible. But that means everything. That means how we use the time, how we use the financial resources, how we roll things out by groups at a time, or which grade levels, and all that sort of stuff. So we're looking at that very carefully.
I just have one more thing. That slide you showed on the student growth percentile.
Yep.
So I guess I just want to say, I think there's some great improvement there, and I think, you know, as individual parents, you know, you might be, an individual parent is not looking at the averages, they're looking at their individual student. And, you know, when those numbers, regardless of what achievement level a student is at, when those numbers are low, you know, below that 40%, it's disconcerting. And this is great news for us, and I just want to highlight that I think we're not talking about it tonight, but I do know just from, I mean, the length of time that my kids have been in the district, that there's been a lot that's gone on to help make that happen. This isn't just like, oh, surprise, like, oh, these are great results, and we don't know why. I think there's lots of things that, you know, you can point to as to why, and many of the things that we have funded and tried to make a priority and that are aligned with the goals. So I just want to say, like, I think that data, I'm very, you know, pleased to see that, recognize that there's still going to be, you know, there's still individual kids that we want to make sure we get every one of them into that 40 to 60 or higher, but that's a big improvement, and it wasn't accidental. There's lots of things that have gone on to help get there. So I appreciate all the work that goes into that sort of simple slide.
Yeah, I mean, even when you look at, I mean, take fifth grade math and you're looking at the last few years, I mean, that's a significant
mm-hmm.
change.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask a question about how student growth has calculated? So up till 2014, it was the whole state, right? So your peers were everyone in the state. With 2015, am I right? Because I'm making an assumption that your peers are the peers who tested like you last year and took the PARC.
No, so it's actually,
okay.
You know,
so
the state has said we're looking to measure growth, this is actually still a very sound way to do it. So essentially this measurement that they've created has always been about two separate tests. In other words, you know, the third grade test is very different than the fourth grade test. So you're looking at students who took who scored similarly as you in the previous year.
Okay.
And then comparing your growth to all of those, that same set of students.
So how did they tie, so everyone took the MCAS in 2014. I'm just trying to understand how to understand the student growth percent how. So everyone took the MCAS in 2014. So you're now a cohort. You've been identified as a similar scoring group of kids. We're gonna track you as a group next year and see how you, to measure your growth. But if half of you took one test and half took another, how did they develop a way to say, well, you scored this on PARC and you scored this on MCAS, and
so
how do you compare
so
that?
So if I scored a four, if I'm a fifth grade student and I scored a four in math, so I can see, well, what did I score in MCAS the previous year? And looking at all the students, that's a really large sample because
right,
it's still
right.
about half the state. Looking at that subset of students that scored the same way I did in fourth grade, and then said, okay, that's that set of students, how did they all now score on the PARC? And what was the range of that? And so most of those kids went to this particular score. I actually outscored them, so I'm in a higher percentile. I don't know if I'm explaining it very well. They have some graphs
that might
be.
Yeah, what they've done is something called
yeah. equi percentile ranking. So what they've tried to do is they have tried to make a link between the achievement scores of the MCAS and the achievement scores of the PARC, and where would you align?
Okay.
So they've done that with these tests for this year, linking them to whatever achievement you got last year.
Good.
So that's how they're able to measure the growth from year to year.
So it
doesn't matter what the test is.
So good. So on these charts where you showed us versus the state average, it is still a true state average. It isn't just a subset who took one test or the other.
Right.
Thank you. That's very helpful. Anything else from the committee? Yes, go ahead.
I just had one. I know we talked about getting a new science curriculum, but I did find it to be a little concerning the grade 8 math. I guess that would be slide 29, where that the level 5 and the achievement level is extremely low. And I know that you take out the algebra 1, and they obviously all did great. So that's your highest level. But with those three tracks of math in eighth grade, I think it's a very low percentage of students in level 5. And I wonder, because we've shifted the math curriculum a little bit, is this a consequence of that?
I'm just looking here on the other handouts. I don't remember offhand. So there were the state average of level 5 in grade 5 was 11%. So yeah, one and a half, but the level of 4 was 44%. So we far exceeded the state average for the 4, but we're a little bit below it for 5. So I agree, that's where we want to go.
Right.
But I don't think it's completely out of the ballpark according to the state averages.
Okay.
If I could explain a couple of pieces to remember now for this one, which is different from your question about growth, you're only dealing with a little over half of the student population.
Right.
Because there are students that are taking MCAS still that are not included in this.
But this is, you're just talking about achievement scores.
Right. Well, no, that's my point. Plus, they're on, not every school district that took the PARC took the grade 8 algebra. Not every eighth grade had an algebra test.
So that 100% who took grade 8 algebra and scored so off the charts.
Correct.
In a district that didn't take grade algebra, those kids are going to make their higher.
Correct.
In fact, I believe there's been districts that offer algebra in middle school that didn't have
that didn't take the algebra test.
Yeah.
The question is it really algebra 1?
You're saying there are districts that do teach algebra 1 in eighth grade but didn't have the students take this algebra?
So. Yeah,
because it wasn't the Common Core.
Okay, but the students took one or the other of these or both of these?
You have to take an eighth grade math.
Math, okay.
Yeah,
so you took either the eighth grade math PARC or the eighth grade algebra 1 PARC.
Right. All of our eighth grade algebra 1 students took the algebra 1 test.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Since we're on the topic of the Algebra 1 test, while I'm thrilled with the 100%, how can you not be happy with 100% proficiency? Mm-hmm. It did make me wonder if perhaps are there students who could be accessing that who aren't? I think I might be reassured if I saw a few level 3s in there. This is such a high level of proficiency. I'm wondering, does that lead you to think that maybe we should reexamine how kids are placed in Algebra 1?
Yeah, that's something certainly we're going to be doing. We have that data of where the students were in that cutoff for recommendation, and so we could also see how they performed on the eighth grade test. But also on the other hand, to say, even this is such a rigorous, I mentioned that there are districts that chose not even to do this. It's been ironic. I've had several calls in the last several months from districts that are asking for experiences, advice, saying we offer algebra, it's not really algebra 1. I mean, they're all over the place and sort of how they're trying to arrange and figure out their steps and moving forward. And our approach has been to accelerate a student that much. We want to absolutely make sure we're doing no harm.
Yeah.
That they are well placed and that they are able to meet expectations. And so to see that made us feel really good. There's no question that we're going to examine. Our hope is too that as we're getting, now this is 3 years of the foundational approach, that those numbers could go up. I mean, we're going to be looking at that every year.
Mm-hmm.
As I've said before, our goal is that the numbers of students, the percentages of students accessing higher mathematics as they go on in high school should increase, not decrease. That's our goal. In the past, we saw a huge dropping off, right, attrition of students who seemed to be succeeding, but truly once they got beyond algebra, they did not have the firm conceptual understandings to continue. And so our goal is now we want to increase those numbers moving forward. So,
I would like to say that some of the work that I did on my own, looking at these, I think the state average can be useful, especially for trending over time. We're always about the state average, but are we getting further? Are we getting closer? I think that's very valuable. In their budget book, we have identified peer communities, and I really like that approach. So you're not just comparing yourself to the state average, which is a huge, everyone from rural districts in Western Mass to cities like Lawrence and Springfield.
Yep.
Find communities that are somewhat like Reading, as close as we can, demographically, socioeconomically, size-wise, budget-wise. So just something to think about going forward is having that as an additional measure. Here's how we did relative to our state, but here's how we did relative to our peers
we've
identified.
I'd really like
to see that in the future.
Yeah, and you're saying it well there, but just let me echo it because I want to make sure no one walks away thinking that I'm viewing how we're doing against the state as some sort of measure of success.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not, but when I was really sort of struggling, thinking I do want to see the comparison how we're doing. And then it kind of dawned on me that, well, seeing that difference from year to year to year
mm-hmm.
will give us some indication, at least in this transitional stage. Overall, as we go on, that is not our measure of success. We have an expectation that we're going to be doing well above the state average. But to see the change on the previous year, I thought could be helpful in these initial steps. So, but yeah, no, I agree. By looking at other districts, we'll do that as well.
And the only other thing I'll add is, if anybody is really as much of a data geek as I am, I looked at districts who scored comparably, who felt suburban. You know, so I kind of said, oh, that feels like a Reading. I looked at a bunch of them. I looked at the groups that scored near where we did, and then I just looked at their most recent per pupil expenditure,
mm-hmm.
and it's striking. And to Mrs. Webb's point, the outcomes that we're getting with less resources
mm-hmm.
is striking, and something, this didn't happen by accident, and I think it represents an improvement from last year. And so I applaud all of the enormous amount of effort that went into it.
Are there any other committee questions before we go out to the public? Any committee?
I just have one more. And I think I'm revisiting something that's already been said. But the question was around looking at who qualifies to go to the grade 8 Algebra
mm-hmm.
1. And I know there was some talk about testing versus teacher referral, that kind of thing. How is it being done now?
So it's a combination of things. It's a combination of some assessments, teacher recommendation, but also data throughout the year. So it's not just one window of time, but seeing how they're performing throughout the year, and even down to specific questions on unit assessments that we've identified as sort of those stretch assessments that really show a student's ability to apply the concept even in a sort of a novel situation. And if a student is able to do that, clearly they're showing some understandings beyond their grade level. So it's a combination of all of those things.
Thanks.
Thank you. Anything else from the committee? All right.
I just have one question. I'm actually sorry Erica is not here, because I think I would like her input. You know, this year, particularly given the focus on testing, I was kind of curious if the schools are looking at the level of testing duress in our students and how is that being addressed? You know, because there was nationwide issues about testing, I'm sure there were in the schools. So I didn't know if that is something that's looked at, if it's included in the survey she does, if that's just feedback from teachers. I'm curious if that's something that's being addressed.
Yeah. I don't recall in the survey, the youth risk behavior survey, that it specifies testing. I think if you know, that the questions about, that includes school related
mm-hmm.
or about grades,
yeah.
A's and B's, I would sort of throw that in there. But I don't think there's anything specific. I mean, teachers individually, you know, through their own observations and their anecdotal evidence and how students respond to assessments.
Mm-hmm.
I also think using different types of assessments, I don't think assessment overall is a bad word. There's lots of different ways
that we can be assessing yeah.
without sort of the great big test. I think we're trying to get away from that. I mean, I personally, all of the political debate that's occurred around, you know, the Common Core and PARC and all of that, that it's brought our country's attention to the big question about how much testing is helpful and how much is harmful.
Well,
I absolutely think that's a good thing.
What
yeah.
plays out on that classroom level.
Yeah.
And I didn't
yeah.
know if there's any way that she actually, you know, observes that or...
Yeah, I don't think through the survey data, maybe that's something that we should look at, but it certainly is on the radar of teachers and how you can assess, putting more focus on formative assessments that don't create such a stressful situation. You know, one of the things I've learned too, and I mean, I've had some discussions with the community about this, it kind of going a little bit off on a tangent about the nation sort of awareness
yeah.
of this, and that is how the state assessments has played into it, that I've realized that I'm not quite sure Massachusetts had the same awareness as other states in terms of how it was playing out. In other words, we live in a state that placed our bar very high
mm-hmm.
for our state assessment. And as they are aligning to new standards, they're doing the same, whatever tool that they end up using or developing, their goal is they're going to have a very high bar. I think initially, at least among the educator realm, the goal was, you know, should we be talking about some sort of place nationally where, you know, what sort of height should that bar be placed? Because around the country, there were states that were left to place their bar wherever they wanted to. And as I've seen now, some states that have been giving, whether it's the park assessment or the Smarter Balance or other ones that they've created to align with new standards, we're seeing a tremendous drop in the proficiency rates. And so, I mean, we as educators knew that essentially around the country there were thousands and thousands of students that I called it a charade, right? That states were saying, we have 70-80% of our students that are proficient. When, forget Park, I would say, take the MCAS. They're not. And so the fact that in some states now they're seeing that huge drop, some, I won't mention states' names, but I've seen some recently that have gone like from 75 to 35. Well, that's not happening in Massachusetts. Now, that's different than, you know, a local or a state perspective. But if you're talking about children across the country, that was a real issue in education. Yeah. That, you know, we essentially said, we put accountability measures in place saying, okay, you all have to have testing and there's going to be accountability consequences. But no one ever thought to say, well, but the bar better be somewhere in this.
Right, I'm less concerned about that compared nationally, and just more, you know, certainly in the high school, you know, it's not just the testing, but it's whether it's AP classes or particularly with our high school, students and pressure to pack their resume, it's all the same academic pressure that really does present big issues.
It's true, AP tests, SAT, ACT, I mean, I hope that Massachusetts is able to lead the way for this and that Reading is able to advocate for that. I mean, there are states, for instance, that have decided, you know, their high school students are taking SATs, ACTs, and that is their state test.
Right.
You know, especially now that they're aligning more to the standards.
Mm-hmm.
So any way that we're able to find that to reduce the amount of testing, not only for the stress, but to free up more instructional days, more instructional time, kids benefit from that. So I'm hoping that that's something that we're continuing to look at.
Yes, Mrs. Rep.
So I just want to, a week ago, we had, last meeting, Lena Williams and Adam Bach are here, and, you know, they gave a great presentation. So I think when you look at how, you know, supposedly Park is aligned to, you know, expectations that make a student college ready, I think that we always have to keep in mind as we look at assessment strategies, you know, that we're preparing our students well for what they experience at the university level. And I think the data shows that we've been doing a great job. I'm very excited about some of the things that Lena talked about that they're, you know, going to look at with some of the data resources that we're able to get. But I think it's, you know, that's the other piece of it. Like, I understand the chart that Erica presented, what are the things that stress the kids out? I get it, school's a piece of that. But you can't, you know, you have to make sure that we're preparing kids and that the variety of assessments and their exposure to the different types of assessments has them well prepared for the colleges that they want to aspire to. So I think we can't lose sight of the other side of that.
Any other questions on this topic?
From the Mass Conference, a counterpoint to what Mrs. Webb was saying is that, yes, it's important to prepare our kids for college and career readiness, but really the goal is even beyond that for life. We had a wonderful speaker who talked about what really matters and the competition that goes on between the American test results and the European test results and Asian test results, and that his point was that although our scores might be lower on those particular standardized tests, what he's found in his research is that although the other students from other countries score higher, they don't want to do it anymore. They don't want to practice the science. They're not really interested. Whereas if you're you're looking at what really matters, that's motivating students to be creative and to be lifelong learners and to do other things. So it's that balance between preparing them for their next steps, and testing might be a part of that, but we want to make sure that the testing also doesn't squelch the flame for what they might be best, focusing on their strengths, which might not be taking a test.
It's true. I mean, I've told this story before, but I had the opportunity, good fortune, about 10 years ago, I think it was, was invited to present at a conference in Beijing, China. It was at the height, the irony in hindsight was that it was sort of at the height of our country being very focused on how do we really, you know, do these tests. And the questions that I was being asked by educators in China was, we know how to do that. We're actually not so much interested in that. We're trying to shift. What we're interested from you is, how do we help our students be creative and innovative? Because you're beating us on that. Mm-hmm. So it was ironic that we were kind of at different ends in sort of our progress as a nation, perhaps.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
I think we're moving on to reports. Hey, are you ready to tell us what's going on in the life of Reading students?
Yeah, the girls' swim team came in third place at the state meet.
Woohoo.
So that's awesome. And also this week and the end of last week was Spirit Week, and we're getting ready for Thanksgiving and the pep rally on Wednesday.
So this Saturday, the football team upset Marshfield to win the Eastern Mass State Championship, and we'll be taking on Neshoba December 5th at Gillette Stadium for the Super Bowl. This Thanksgiving is the Thanksgiving Day game against Stoneham at 10:15 at Reading. And the Rotary Luncheon was this morning. Were you guys all there?
I was there. Mr. Robinson was there. I think we were the only two committee mm-hmm. members who were there.
Yeah, well, it went well. Food was good, so.
Lunch or breakfast?
Lunch.
There's a breakfast, I think,
oh,
on Thanksgiving
lunch.
Day.
Oh, the breakfast is Thanksgiving
breakfast
Day?
Is
yep.
Thanksgiving
yeah.
Day.
This is the
yeah.
annual Rotary, Stoneham Reading Rotary Luncheon that they have
oh.
with the captain speaking.
Oh, yeah,
it was absolutely wonderful. The Stoneham and Reading Rotaries come together, and it's the Stoneham football team, the Reading football team, the Stoneham cheerleaders, the Reading cheerleaders. It's really lovely before what promises to be a very
yeah.
aggressive game, no doubt, for everyone to get together and remember what sport is all about. And I'd like to tell you what a phenomenal job you and your two fellow co-captains did. You spoke beautifully. You represented yourself and the school beautifully. So very nice work. Nice work. And so excited about Thursday's game. So excited. Okay. Committee reports. Nothing from you? You don't have any? Okay. Dr. Doxer.
So I'll start with the report for the Mass Association of School Committees, because then the second one would be about the CPAC, and I want to make sure that I leave room also for Mrs. Wilson to talk about that. What I did, because there's so much to say about the conference, instead of saying it all, I wrote it out, and so hopefully committee members will be able to get a copy of it, and it will be posted, so if anybody else is interested, that they will be able to see it. It was very helpful both for the content of the workshops, but also for interacting with other school committee members. And I actually came to really appreciate, I already appreciated our school committee, but I did even more after participating in the delegate convention, because I saw what it could be like. And we're not like that. I really appreciate the way our committee works together, so thank you very much. One of the first workshops I went to was on Chapter 70, and that was really interesting. They took it down to the basics and led us all the way through the commission report, and it was very interesting to hear the results of the commission report, because last spring I had the honor of going to one of the hearings with Mrs. Siebert and Dr. Daugherty. And so it was really interesting to hear how this commission pulled together all of their results. And some really key findings were that they found that The school districts are actually needing 144% above the current foundation budget to address the difference between the funding and the actual funds spent to address student needs. So I can't go into all of it now, but it's not just Reading that's struggling to have our budget meet the student needs. It's a lot of high costs with insurance and things we have no control of that sidetrack the funds that Chapter 70 had in mind for supporting our student growth and education. And so the commission, I actually have a link to their report. The commission found they challenged the state to really come and look at what's needed in the districts to fund the services. And they didn't even have a chance to analyze the special ed funds. So they encouraged the districts to keep track of our data and to call in our legislators and present to our legislators what we're finding between the difference between what funding we get and what we can provide our students. So that was a really important message that we got. So I was specifically asked to report on the delegate meeting, the annual delegate meeting, because I was the only one there at that particular time. I had the honor of representing our school committee to vote on the slate for next year, the officers for MASC, and also a number of resolutions. I did my best sitting there thinking of what every school committee might have been thinking about each of it. It was interesting to hear the discussion. So there was a petition, and I'm just going to bullet them, the decisions that were made, so that I don't take everybody's time. But again, this document will be available. So there was a petition to the legislator to study the best starting time for middle and high schools. Mm-hmm. Again, Reading is on the cusp. Newton called this for this study. So we are not alone in our concerns about start times. Also, there were two resolutions about supporting students from low income and poverty that the school districts are mandated to provide the services, and yet Chapter 70 and state funding doesn't actually help us fund that. Another resolution related to an act which actually does support students of poverty and homeless students, but they pointed out that homeless students are really vulnerable because they get placed in, and so are districts, because the homeless students get placed in hotels, and then they have a limit on how long they can stay in those hotels. So they're moved from service to service, mm-hmm. which might be outside of their home base. And so there was a call to the state to look at that and try to change and support our more vulnerable students. There was also a call for the state to recognize that there are students that have been in schools like charter schools that are moved out of those schools to public schools, and then the public schools are judged according to the scores of those students. And so there was a call for the state to take into account where students are educated when they have their test scores, so that the scores, the low scores of some students who might have been struggling, don't reflect on a community where that student wasn't actually educated, because they move right before the tests. So that was passed. There was a vote on a moratorium on high stakes testing, and that was actually came through as an instructional motion that it should be looked at. The amount of testing should be looked at. Tax reform ballot, they were just looking for a way, because there was a recognition of a certain size pie. There's only so many funds to go around. And so they were looking to find a way to increase the size of the pie, increase the amount of funding that can go to Chapter 70, which is something that had been called for in the past, that actually, and so that became a very political debate, very partisan debate about whether to raise the tax rate on the more affluent affluent citizens of the state, and that did not pass. It was close, but it did not pass. They voted to request to add a school committee member to the Board of Elementary and Secondary Education, which was really a revelation to me that there wasn't one. So that I was very pleased to have that. And also a question about GOLD assessment testings for kindergartens, which doesn't so much apply to Reading, but those who are getting certain funding for kindergarten, full-day fund kindergarten. So in terms of workshops I attended, there was that one I mentioned about cultural proficiency, which was very interesting, board superintendent relationships, and there is a handout that will be on there that I'm gonna post, 8 characteristics of effective school boards at a glance, which was really helpful. Went to another workshop that talked about managing your message and media, and that also has been sent to Mrs. Engelson to share. A report on NEASC, which was really encouraging because they had dissenters and critics of the process as well as those who are participating, and I was really proud to be a part, as Mr. Baker reported, we're going to be one of the pilot districts for that coming up, the new process, and that's going to be a much more formative and responsive process to each of the districts that undertake it. So it really promises to be a much more functional and affordable process, and one that will help us move forward with skills, self-reflective skills that will be positive. I can tell that I'm taking too long. So there was also our superintendent presented on a DSE evaluation program, planning for success, and that was also another tool for us to be able to look at ourselves, which has been very helpful, which has led up to the forums that everybody has participated in and which will be ongoing as well. And the presentation by Yang Zhao that I mentioned, Educating World-Class Learners, Educating Creative and Entrepreneurial Students, which was really a hysterically presented, valuable presentation about looking at what really matters in education and gearing our assessments to that and enabling our students and looking towards their strengths rather than their deficits. So in a nutshell, that's that. And I'm very grateful to have been able to go to this conference. I learned a lot, and I hope to bring it back to the discussions here. And then the other report I have, 2 reports. One is December 3rd is the Human Relations Advisory Committee next meeting. We're doing a tree at the Reading Education Foundation Festival of Trees. Please come. It's actually, I misspoke. We're not doing a tree, we're doing a display because we're keeping diversity in mind and not everybody can use a tree afterwards. So you'll have to come to see what we do. It's going to be very different and hopefully okay. And then the last report is on the CPAC, Special Education Parent Advisory Council, which I was very excited to be a part of. There were very devoted and educated citizens, parents who were participating in this meeting, and they got a lot done in that first meeting, including looking at the bylaws and adapting them so that it would enable the committee to make a difference and to work with the school committee and the schools and our pupil services director. And also they decided on board members with some spaces left. So a heads up to people out there who might be interested in working with the board. And they reformatted the board so that there would still be liaisons to the different schools, so there'd still be the hot top talk and the ways to get other people informed. but it wouldn't be, the process wouldn't be held up if they couldn't get a quorum. They worked on the quorum number as well. So I'd like to ask Mrs. Wilson if she has other things she'd like to add to that.
Sure. Is that all right if I go?
Yes, absolutely.
Sorry. So we did meet. They decided to elect a board. Right now we have 5 members. They're Nicole Fidus, Kate Goldlust, Alicia Williams, Terry Texera, and Rob Carney. They're all parents who will be serving on the board. They haven't quite finalized what the structure will be, if there will be a chair, a vice chair. They're looking to meet again on December 10th at 7 to do some more work on this, but they seem very excited. We had about 18 parents who came, which was really great for a second meeting. And so I talked a lot with them about working directly with my office and how we can support the work they're doing. But it was very productive and it was very parent driven, which was very nice. The first time in my tenure to have a meeting that was facilitated purely by parents.
That's fantastic.
Fantastic.
That's great. Anything else, Dr. Doxer?
No, that's enough.
Thank you.
Yes.
Just one other quick thing. So the school committee and central office are also doing a tree in support of the Festival of Trees. So I just want to remind the community that the actual Festival of Trees is December 5th and 6th. So make sure you prioritize your time so that you can go to the festival. And Gillette.
The game's not till 6.
Good. 6 p.m. Excellent.
That's
plenty of time to
day.
Go to the Festival of Trees. So anyway, just it's an
Thank
important
you.
Community event. They provide, REF provides so much funding for teacher grants. So
they do. They do. Thank you, Mrs. Webb, for taking a lead on our tree this year.
Yes.
I have a couple of reports for the committee. The Recreation Committee is continuing to look at lighting of our fields. I don't have a specific report, but I have been in contact with John Fudo at the, who's the recreation director, and I know he and Dr. Doherty and Tom Zaya, our athletic director, have been collaborating really well on articulating what the priority for field lighting will be. So you're going to be hearing more about that in the future. It continues to be a work in process, try to get more fields lit in town to support our student athletes. I also attended the MASC workshop of annual conference, and it was wonderful, phenomenal. There's as much learning outside of the workshops. You get to interact with school committee members and administrators from other communities, and it does make you grateful to be in Reading. And the last update, this committee knows, but for the public, the Reading School Committee has been going through a district governance program. It's an optional program offered by the Massachusetts Association of School Committees. We embarked on it, we decided over this summer to begin this process. And we graduated. This Saturday was our last workshop. It was a really great experience. Dorothy Pressa led us through. She's a longtime school committee woman from Linfield. She works with the MASC. She really helped us learn some best practices. I will say that we were able to get through the program quicker than is typical, largely because of how high-functioning our committee is. And it was very rewarding to really an expert consultant from the outside come in and say, well, you're already doing a lot of things really, really well. That was very reassuring. That being said, we picked up some tips and some tricks and some improvements. We've adopted a consent agenda, which we had tonight for the first time, which should streamline our meetings. We adopted operating protocols that we wrote and collaborated on. And coming up next, we'll be updating our public comment policy for better clarity. And we have Dr. Doxer working on a brochure that will be available eventually when people come in that explains what the school committee is, what it does, what it doesn't do, and how to interact effectively with us as a board. And Mrs. Joyce has voluntarily taken on the challenge of creating a handbook for newly elected school committee members and also people in the community who might be interested in running, to kind of give a guideline of what it is that we do and how we function. So I think there's some exciting things coming forward from our committee in the future. So that is it for my report. Let me make sure that really is that committee. Yes. Are there any other committee reports? Good. Administrative reports.
Karen, do you
want me to just report? I just wanted to quickly let you know what happened on Friday, November 20th. We had conferences happening for elementary and high school. middle school participated in some professional development, and I planned professional development for our paraprofessionals. So they had a full day from 8 to 3. Some of our paraprofessionals received their QBS restraint recertification. Some were involved in youth mental health first aid. Sarah Bird and I were actually discussing between the last professional day and this professional day, we have trained 90 additional staff between those days. We ran sessions on literacy for our paraprofessionals that were run by our literacy coach. We ran math sessions by our math coach. We also had some kind of general strategies for inclusion for middle school and high school. We did a session on bullying. We had someone from the North Shore Consortium come out and do some specialized training on that. John did an ALICE training that I think went over very well, a good review for a lot of the paraprofessionals. We had Lisa Studer, our BCBA, did training at the RISE with elementary, middle, and high school on behavior and data collection. We also had some of our speech pathologists working with our RISE paraprofessionals on language development. We had an MTSS overview done by one of our consultants from WIDECO. And I think that is about it. So it was a really good day. I reviewed feedback. I had feedback sheets, paper copies, not a Survey Monkey, to just get feedback. And it seems overall, I think the feedback was great, and that it was topics that were really geared to our paraprofessionals to help them in their jobs day to day. And a lot of the feedback was, oh, I wish we had more time on this topic. So it will really help guide us in the future to target what they're doing. And we did offer a lot of different sessions than they've had previously.
I don't have anything to speak.
You've already done a lot of talking. I have several items. First, I want to start out with that. Several of us had the opportunity on Saturday to go to Coolidge Middle School and see the first annual Science Expo, which was put on by several groups, including the Reading Education Foundation, the Reading Robotics team, different groups in the Reading Public Schools. It was coordinated by some of our parents, Eileen Manning, Marianne Downing, and Kristen Murray. And it was amazing to see the variety of activities, the variety of projects, the energy level and the enthusiasm of our students to pick something that they were genuinely interested and invested in. When you walked into the multipurpose room, you saw several displays of students with their projects, some of them experiments that they had researched, some of them being straight projects where they did research in a topic and displayed it and reported it out. We even had someone who didn't call it Deflategate, but clearly did an experiment on the PSI of footballs, which was very interesting. And you went into the gymnasium and you saw demonstrations by the Reading Robotics team, and I believe Burlington was there also. Looked like Burlington's robotics team was there as well. And then when you went into the cafeteria, you saw a variety of hands-on experiments going on where kids were able to just get into an experiment and, you know, play around with it and see how it worked. So it was a great day for kids to get excited about science. Very well attended. I'm sure it's just going to continue to grow over the years. So I just want to thank everyone that was involved with that. The Reading Chronicle beat me to the punch, but you may have noticed the other day that we're part of a research study that was done by the Rennie Center and ASCD, which is the Association for Supervision and Curriculum Development. We were one of three school districts in Massachusetts that were researched on the topic of social emotional learning. So they took a look at a variety of different ways that it's implemented in school districts. And so Reading is very well highlighted and mentioned in this report. I will send this out to you electronically.
And it was front page of the Chronicle on Friday.
Friday.
Yeah, above the fold.
Yep. So this is what it looks like if you start on the front page of the Chronicle. I also want to, speaking of social emotional learning, Sarah Bird and I have been on for over a year now the Safe and Supportive Schools Commission, which it consists of 25 voting members. They were all appointed by the governor. to take a look at how do we streamline all of the different initiatives involved with social emotional learning, as well as come up with a series of recommendations so that school districts can easily implement best practices in these areas. This is a commission that does not have a sunset to it, and so we are, by statute, we have to deliver a report to the legislature by December 31st of every year that we're in existence. So we put the finishing touches on the draft report, which will be released in the next couple of weeks to the legislature, and when I get that report, I will send it out to you as well. But it was a very good first step in the process, and we look forward to next year when we get to drill down and do even more work in this important area. Let's see. The community forums that I've been presenting to both staff and to the community, I did get taped by RCTV's. Actually, I got taped by the Reading High School help desk, Rocket Help Desk. So that's going to be on RCTV probably in the next week or so. The students are going to put that together, edit the tape, and so that will be on RCTV and on YouTube. And let's see. Just I also attended the MASC conference, and I just want to highlight. I attended several workshops as well. The one that I do want to talk about briefly is the one where I was part of a panel discussion on the action planning for success, which is what we use this year to develop our district plan, which I know Dorothy mentioned in the workshop, is the alignment, you know, the five goals and the specific action plans with the benchmarks for each of those goals. So again, it shows that alignment, and this is something that, you know, started actually 6 years ago when I was part of the new superintendent's induction program, and the way that they had outlined for us how you should be doing a district plan. And then by piloting this with the DESE, allowing to drill down even further by the five different goals. So each school district that was there, and I think there were five school districts that were on the panel, talked about how they're using it in the school district. But it was a very useful process, and it makes it a much more efficient process, which is what I think we want as well. That's all I have.
Do we have anything else to see?
I just have one more announcement. So Alex talked about the success of the girls swim team. Mm-hmm. So every year the girls and the boys swim team do a fun meet, and it was originally scheduled for December 5th. They rescheduled it for December 4th at 8 p.m. at the Burbank Y, and it's done as a fundraiser, so I know they donate some amount of the proceeds to the Y to reach out. But it's a great evening, so it can be a full packed weekend, starting with the girls-boys race and a football game, Reading against Neshoba, and the Festival of Trees. So we hope it doesn't snow so we can all get to where we want to go safely that whole week.
Thank you. Anything else? All right, next school committee meeting is December 7th. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
Make the motion to adjourn.
I second.
All in favor? We are adjourned.